Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Berean Baptist Church for this, our Sunday night service. And yeah, that means for everybody to get to their normal locations. Very, very good. Okay. It's good to have each and every one of you here tonight and for our Sunday night service. And just want to thank you for Sunday morning. This morning was a special day. We got to see a new little one come in the door, you know. Yeah, we believe in kind of starting our church members early, like at 4 weeks old. And anyway, special day. Anyway, we're going to start by singing. We're going to sing because as long as we sing, Liam will stay asleep. As soon as I start preaching, he will wake up. So let's stand together. Brother Carl's going to give us the song here.
497. 497, Brighten the Corner. Let's all stand, please.
As we have a word of prayer together, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come into your house and be your people. And Lord, as we preached this morning, it is not hard for you to identify who your people are. And because of that, we thank you for the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the gift of salvation. We thank you for the opportunity of transformation, that transforming work that you want to do in each and every one of us. And I pray, Lord, that we would never ever get to a point in our lives where we say, that's enough, I don't want to be transformed anymore. I pray that you would help us to strive to grow closer in you, to grow in you, to grow stronger in you, to grow more and more in the knowledge of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we pray, Lord, as we seek a reviving in our own lives, that you would do the work that only you can do, even this night. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And you may be seated, and we're going to sing a couple more songs right now.
Okay, let's turn to number 27, way back to 27. Something About That Name. Amen. We'll sing through it twice.
Jesus, Jesus, take me, Jesus, measure slowly, about that man.
wonderful singing and just looking. What a wonderful morning. I had at least two people tell me that Southside Baptist Church really pulled their weight this morning. They really did. Now, it's looking a little thin again. Art and Susie, thank you for helping there and kind of bringing up the population there. See, we have Northside Baptist Church over here. We have Southside Baptist Church over here. We have Topside Baptist Church up top there. And so now you do realize you're gonna lose a couple this week. And so, you know, you're going to have to apply for the Topside Baptist Church replacement program. And in James and Roxy, we've been glad to have you here this weekend. I'm sure you've enjoyed your son and daughter-in-law and the grandkids more. I know how that goes. And but anyway, glad to have you here. Let me make mention of a few things. First, let me talk to the homeschool. The homeschool, you know what a snow day is, don't you? If you have a snow day, you know what a snow day is, right? Well, tomorrow you're going to have a schnoz day. It's not a snow day, it's a schnoz day. And what it is the curriculum coordinator is under the weather, and so you're going to have a home study day tomorrow, and just continue to pray that Mrs. Andreessen gets to feeling a little better. So just want to let you know that. And make mention of a few things, some of the announcements here. Again, annual meeting, sign up, talk to Brother Carl if you have any questions. The sign up is in the back, and that is for those, of course, that are members of Berean Baptist Church and those who may be prospective members of Berean Baptist Church, and it's our annual meeting. And there is a menu. I think I told you this morning, lasagna was on the menu. I'll probably tell you again on Wednesday, lasagna's on the menu. And for those who are at Roosters and go, well, when I go to Roosters, lasagna's not on the menu. And at that point I go, yes, that's exactly why you need to become a member of Berean Baptist Church. If you do that, you get lasagna. And they make it special there. And so anyway, they have that, and they have the chicken Dijon, and they have the Cobb salad. And anyway, so the sign-up is in the foyer, so you can look for that, get signed up for that. And then also, I did not get the sign-up sheet done for the Redmond trip, but if you have any questions, please ask me. Please pray about going to this. And I know it's a little bit of a sacrifice of time. Somebody may even have to take a day off to be able to go there. But this is trying to give birth to a work of God, something that's only possible through God's help. But it does take, God gives us feet. And it's a door hanger outreach, and every individual doing the exercise of hanging door hangers is such a great help. Again, we would leave, this is March 3rd, we would leave 1 p.m. on Friday. I will make sure we have accommodations. You may want to bring a little bit of food money. And at 10 o'clock, we will have about 2 hours of door hanging, and then we will have lunch, and then we will head home, probably be home around 5 p.m. on Saturday. But any help is greatly, greatly appreciated. Just want you to think about that. And then ladies sign up for the ladies meeting. That is this Saturday, luncheon, not lunch, but luncheon. Men, it's lunch. Ladies, it's luncheon. Luncheon at noon. And anyway, you ladies are going to have a wonderful time again. No greater love is the theme, and there's going to be a craft. It's going to be a fabulous time. Be sure to sign up in the back for that. Brother Glenn. Okay, the guys have an extracurricular activity in an undisclosed location that Brother Glenn will disclose. And so anyway, we will let you know about that. And so that will take place. And then let me just say to the congregation, I want to say we ask God what to do, and then we do what God wants us to do. And that's a reflection of our obedience to the Lord, and very often it's a reflection of generosity to the gospel. And so we had an offering this morning. That offering is to try to help another pastor who's starting a church, who has a need right now. And you know, I tend to be averse on announcing offering figures for fear that someday they'll take a Christmas offering for the pastor and then announce he got $223.17, and somebody will start going, oh yeah, that's $0.33 a person. And so I often don't do that, but the offering was over $6,600. And so I think you need to know that. And the only response on the other end when I sent them the figure was, wow. You know, what a blessing. We really want to help them, and it's important to know what God is able to do even through us. And so continue to pray as he's still working to the end of February to raise the funds, but you've been part of that, helping that ministry, and I'm very thankful for that. So just letting you know those things that are taking place. And there, of course, are many other things taking place. Remember, we have Subtle Care at 3:30. We do have Mackay Creek Bible Study, Subtle Care 3:30 Tuesday, Mackay Creek Bible Study 12:30 p.m. on Thursday this week as well. So just letting you know everything that's going on. We'll still have men's prayer at a regular time. I had one newer attender come up to me this morning, went, I didn't know that was every week. I go, yeah, it's every week. Goes, wow, I'm going to be there on Saturday. And so it takes a little while. And you know, God is blessing us with these new and returning visitors. And so we're very, very grateful for that. And some of these are an answer to prayer. Some of these are an answer to somebody's prayer. We didn't even know they were praying. And so we just pray as God continues to do what he does with his work. And so we're going to sing again. We're going to praise God again. Brother Carl is going to come up and he's going to lead us in a couple more songs. Brother Carl.
Okay, let's turn to number 329, The Cleansing Wave, 329.
Cleansing spring, I see, I sing, I plunge and open it.
remain standing if you can. Please turn in your Bibles to Nehemiah chapter 8. Book of Nehemiah chapter 8. And as you're turning there again, let me make this mention again. If you are interested in going to the Pastors and Workers Conference in Santa Clara, California, this is the last day to get the early bird rate on registration, which is $70. That goes up to $85 tomorrow. And you know, if you're interested, you may want to apply online. Again, we're trying to do everything we can. We're going to rent a vehicle so that we can kind of carpool down there and do what we can to help in the travel and everything. But I just want to let you know that's happening. This is going to be a fantastic conference. Dr. Treiber is already advertising that. On Friday he advertised. And one of the things that he's going to do, he's going to dedicate much of the conference. See, the singing's over. He's going to dedicate much of the conference regarding a great man of God who's gone to heaven, Dr. Bobby Robertson. He is the pastor of Gospel Light Baptist Church in Walkertown, North Carolina. My wife and I met him. In fact, the church I pastored in Kalispell was named after his church by the founding pastor. It was also called Gospel Light Baptist Church when we were there. But what a dear man of God. We got a chance to meet him several times. They called him the Prince of Preachers because in an age where you can get into the Deep South and you have camps, and you have First Baptist, you can go to a town, a southern town, you got First Baptist Church, and you've got Second Baptist Church, you've got Third Baptist Church, and you have Fourth Baptist Church, and you have Fifth Baptist Church, because Second Baptist Church split from First, and Third split from Second, and Fourth split from Third. I mean, that's how it went. You know, they kind of said, oh, it's like cell division, you know, that type of thing. And the reality is, he is a prince of preachers, and he loved all preachers. And he loved churches, and sometimes he'd have somebody leave, and then he'd go preach a conference about an hour away, and he'd see some of his former church members go, oh, I was always wondering where you went to, but he's just so very, very kind to people. And really, a man, we're so grateful that we had a chance to know him. And then I'm going to do something on Wednesday. Craig, I'm going to have you zoom in. I know I don't ask you to do that, but I'm going to have you zoom in. I'm talking to you. But I'm also talking to the Facebook crowd at the moment, and I want to talk about something very important to the congregation. On, I think it was Thursday, I sent you a link to a YouTube video that I thought was very, very critical, and I wanted you to see it. That YouTube video, it had come out of Crown College. And it was an interview with Dr. Matthew Whiteside, so incredibly important. He is a true scientist, by the way. He didn't give any opinions, he just presented the facts. And so who could have anything against something that's actually facts? And you're just presenting the information. But YouTube blocked that video in less than 24 hours. And I discovered it was still on Facebook, and then my phone said, would you like to download this? And I went, yes. And I was able to download it. I edited it to the part that I wanted, and I created my own YouTube video, and I presented it to you folks. It lasted 2 hours before YouTube took it down again. And the reality is, there's somebody who doesn't want you to know the facts. And, you know, this is of a truth, violation of First Amendment and censorship of the truth. And they say, well, we can get away with it because we're a private company, private, woke, hyper-liberal company. And it just so happens that Facebook is owned by somebody else. And so it's still on Facebook. And the reason I have you zoomed in is I'm talking to the Facebook world here right now because I want you to know that on Wednesday I'm going to rebroadcast that video in the Wednesday night service. And I want you to let everybody know it's going to be broadcast. Because, yeah, there are certain things that are talking. We're talking about science, but we're also talking about Scripture. And we're also talking about truth. We're talking about some very, very critical and vital things that are happening. And you know, I could sometimes pick something up on the internet and I'd go, well, that person's a Yahoo or a nut job, but I know this man. And he's none of the sort. And so I know that he has already verified his information and he has the correct information. And so anyway, I'm letting you, the congregation, know that I am going to do this. Because several of you, you couldn't get to the play button fast enough. It was already gone. And I think the word needs to get out. So I'm doing my part. I'm not only telling you this, I'm going to basically forward this to pastors all over the region so that they can get a hold of this. So just letting you know that. You can zoom out now. I will turn myself back into regular Sunday night service. Nehemiah chapter 8, we're looking at verses 1 through 9 tonight. Nehemiah chapter 8, looking at verses 1 through 9. The Bible says, "And all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate, and they spake unto Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded to Israel." Now you may ask, say, okay, they're gathering together for the reading of the Word of God. Why didn't they just all funnel in into the temple? And the reality is there's too many of them to funnel in. And so they had to meet outside because there was not enough room for them to meet inside. So you would call this the very first original parking lot service right here. "And Ezra the priest brought the law before the congregation, both of men and women, and all that could hear with understanding upon the first day of the seventh month. And he read therein before the street that was before the water gate from the morning until midday, before the men and the women and those that could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive unto the book of the law. And Ezra the scribe stood upon a pulpit of wood which they had made for the purpose." By the way, we call this the pulpit. This is actually not the pulpit. The pulpit is actually the stage I'm on, actually by true description. This is the pulpit of wood. And so, but he had to get above the people so that his voice would carry. That was the primary, and it was made for that purpose. And so, let me get back to where I am here. "Which they had made for that purpose, and beside him stood Mattathiah and Shema and Ananiah and Urijah and Hilkiah and Maaseiah on his right hand and on his left hand, Pediah and Mishael and Melchiah and Hashum and Hashbadana, Zechariah and Meshullam." And so I don't understand. I tried to give these suggestions to Caleb and Abigail, and they named him Liam. So that's right. They didn't want that many syllables. "And as Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people, and when he opened it, all the people stood up." Now you know why you're standing. You know, it's there is a format of how we handle church in the book of Nehemiah chapter 8 here. "And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, amen." Amen. Amen. Not amen. No, amen. Amen. "With lifting up their hands, and they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground." Don't do that just yet. "Also Jeshua and Bani and Sheriba, Jamin, Akub, Shabbatai, Hodijah, Maasa, Kalida, Azariah, Jozabad, Hanan, Peliah, and the Levites caused the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place." And by the way, this is the purpose and mission of the Sunday school, this next verse. "So they read in the book of the law of God distinctly and gave the sense," that's the context, "and caused the people to understand the reading." There's Sunday school for you. "And Nehemiah," which is the Tirshatha, that meant governor, "and Ezra, the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto all the people, this day is holy unto the Lord, your God. Mourn not, nor weep, for all the people wept. when they heard the words of the law. Where is revival seen? We'll get to that in just a moment. Let's have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that you would give me help and strength to do what I can with my ability, and that you would take me beyond that ability, and that you would take your people here with their attention and their ability to listen, and that you would take them beyond their ability, and that you would help us to know and to heed and understand your word so that we can understand where revival comes from, and that you would do a great moving and drawing in our spirits tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Let me give a little bit of history here. Where we are at here in the book of Nehemiah chapter 8, what had just happened? What had just happened is the people of God had seen a miracle of God on the outside. And what I mean by the outside is Nehemiah had come from out of town, literally out of town, way out of town, Medes and Persia capital out of town, and he had come into town. And when he came into town, everybody realized he was important, but nobody knew why he was there. And he didn't tell them why he was there. For 3 days he didn't tell them why he was there. And for 3 days, I know it's hard to think about this, for 3 days, Mick, you will appreciate this, for 3 days, Nehemiah worked graveyard shift. For 3 days. Caleb, you'll appreciate this. He worked graveyard shift for 3 days. And at night, there was him and the beast he rode upon and a couple servants maybe holding torches, and he literally circled in three nights, I should say, the entire city of Jerusalem, and he was examining the walls that were broken down. There's one place he said it was broken down so bad he couldn't even get his beast over it. He just had to go, okay, that's broken. And he went around, and then when he was done, then he called all the people together, and he said, you see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem is burned with fire and the walls are broken down. Come, let us rebuild. Come, let us build the wall so that we will no longer be a reproach. And it says, and then I showed them the good hand of my God upon me. And he showed them the letters of the king, and he showed them everything that was approved and everything. And then the people said to Nehemiah, let us rise up and build. Let's do this thing. And they did. It wasn't easy. But they rebuilt that wall, miles and miles and miles of wall. They rebuilt that wall in 52 days. It's a miracle of God on the outside. And when you see a miracle of God on the outside, that's enough to praise God for. Thomas isn't here, but Thomas says, listen, I have a testimony. And someday in the future, the congregation, Berean Baptist Church, they're going to hear miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle of what God did, everything surrounding the birth of their daughter. But he said, I'm sorry, the adults don't get to hear it first. I want to tell the kids first. Go figure. But a miracle on the outside isn't a miracle on the inside. And revival is not a miracle on the outside. Revival is a miracle on the inside. And so as we look at this, revival is when God sees a miracle of God on the inside. And by the way, it doesn't happen in isolation. It doesn't happen with you in your closet or you in your undisclosed location. History proves revival happens in the assembly. That's where it does happen. And that's where it always will happen when it happens. Where is revival seen? This is the fourth installment. Revival happens in God's house among God's people. And I want to speak about this. And many of you know, I've already kind of given you a lot of background on this. I mean, the reality is revival happened in God's house among God's people in the home church of Jonathan Edwards, where he was the pastor, having taken over for his grandfather who passed away, and revival happened in his church among his people 7 years before it happened across all the 13 colonies. And, you know, I consider Jonathan Edwards an amazing preacher in this sense. And that is, when it happened in his church and it happened in his region, he didn't say, okay, there's now peace and truth in my days. But he continued to strive and to pray until it happened nationwide, before we were even a nation. And then 7 years later, he preached in a church that wasn't even his church. A church where everyone goes, okay, go to that church. Nobody will go to the altar. Nobody will say amen. Nobody will care that you're there. They probably won't even give you a love offering. Go to that church in Connecticut. And he did. And they said when he first got there, the crowd really was not very friendly. In fact, they were resistant to the word of God. And God worked a miracle of revival in the hearts, not simply through preaching, but the preaching of the word of God. We serve the same God. Nothing's changed. Nothing has changed in the halls of heaven regarding the personhood of God and the personhood of Jesus Christ. Nothing has changed regarding the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so I want to give you, I'm not going to give you 3 points. I know you're disappointed. Ten points. And you know, and here's what I say when I have 10 points. You'll be happy to know, no subpoints, but I do have 10 points tonight. And I say, the wonderful thing is, you can write it on the finger of each hand, all 10 points. Somebody please give Jared a piece of paper. And and so let me talk about this. Look with me in the book of Nehemiah, because something must be present in God's house, among God's people, for revival to take place. There's 10 things that I want to talk about. First of all, and this should be obvious, number one, the word of God is present. As we look here, it says, the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate, and they spake unto Ezra the scribe to bring the book of law, the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded to Israel. It says, Ezra, will you please bring us the word of God? We want to hear from the Lord. We have seen a great miracle. We don't know what it means. We don't know where we're supposed to go from here. Would you please bring us the word of God? And understand, where revival is seen, number one, the word of God is always present in revival. The preacher doesn't get up. He doesn't talk Time Magazine. He doesn't talk current events. He doesn't talk Chinese balloons or any other balloons that may be out there. I think we all ought to rent some balloons. And just get, no, rent a big balloon, let the string go. I've always wanted to see a fighter jet. You know? But the reality, I know there's four of them now. So number five's on its way. So, yeah, what they'll discover is there. I have some theories. Never mind. I'm not going to get into that. You'll get me totally diverted here. But understand, the word of God is present. And they spoke the word of the Lord. Because you know what? There's no sense in coming and hearing the word of a man. They're a dime a dozen. And they speak on every network, and they speak on every website, and they speak on every tabloid, and they speak from their basement, and they speak from their garage, and they tell you, I'm somebody important. They flash Dr. So-and-so at the bottom of the screen with the doctorate that they got from some stray mail-order university. You don't have any idea who they are, but since it showed up on the internet, it must be true. You don't need the word of the man, you need the word of God. We need the word of God. It's what we need. And so, first of all, in dealing with this, where is revival seen? The word of God is present. It's not just present. The word of God is esteemed. You notice they didn't come to Ezra and say, Ezra, we just want to know what you think of all this. They could care less what Ezra thought. They didn't even come to Nehemiah the governor and ask, Nehemiah, what do you think of this? They didn't care what Nehemiah had to think about this. They cared what the Word of God had to say. And so it's important. With that, the Word of God is present, and the Word of God is esteemed. And we need to understand God only used the hands of men to write this book, but God wrote the book. And that is the thing that's very, very important when you're dealing with this, is understand that God wrote His Word. And this is an important thing as we deal with this. And so as we deal with this, the Word of God is present, and God's Word is esteemed. But then secondly, I want you to notice something else that happened. As you look here, they read therein before the street that was before the water gate from the morning until midday. Okay, how long is that? Morning till midday. By the way, church services were much longer during that period of time. In other words, they read from morning. Morning could have been about sunrise. Midday, we know what midday is. That's high noon. But you can already read, and you can find that their church services back then lasted 3 to 6 hours. And so I think it's important to understand that. And so, but here's what it says. Catch this at the end of the verse. And the ears of all the people were attentive unto the book of the law. What did this mean? They were paying attention. They were focusing. They were concentrating. So where is revival seen? Number one, the Word of God is present. But number two, attention is present. It doesn't matter what happens up here or even what is read up here if nobody's listening. Attention is present. And I'll tell you something, that is a symptom of revival, because it's very, very hard to get people to pay attention to anything. I mean, there was a movie, and I hate to use movie analogies, but there was an animation movie. It was called Up. It was some guy, and he missed his wife, and he wanted to go see the location where his wife lived, and so he hooked 1,000 balloons to his house to lift his house off the ground to go see where his wife lived. But the thing is, and somewhere along the line, they had a dog, and this dog had a voice box, and the dog is trying to have a conversation. All of a sudden, the dog goes, "Squirrel! I see that almost every church service, you know, where people, they're focused on the pastor, and they go, "Squirrel!" You know, all of a sudden, I go, "Look, the fan is on," and you know, things like that. And so we have this reality. It is a mark of revival when attentiveness comes in, when people lean into the Word of God instead of leaning away from the Word of God. That's a change. And by the way, no pastor can do anything about that. A pastor can stand on his head and spin on his head and do cartwheels and everything like that, and he can't do anything to prevent the squirrel syndrome. Only God can give that attentiveness. That is a work of the Holy Spirit of God when people wake up and they begin to lean in. These people were leaning in. It was a sign of revival taking place at this time. Where is revival seen? Number one, the Word of God is present. Number two, attention is present. And first of all, with the Word of God being present, as we said, God's Word is esteemed. When attention is present, what it comes down to is this: God's Word is worth hearing. It is God's Word. It is His Word. It is God speaking to you and God speaking to me. If I speak to you, I'm sorry, that's a distant second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. But if God speaks, it's worth hearing what God has to say. God's Word is worth hearing. Look at verse 8. So they read in the book of the law distinctly and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. What is going on here? What this means is that men who understand the Word of God are doing the best they know how to do in their ability to communicate clearly what the Word of God says. There's one time, very first church I went to, and you know, when you come into a church, you inherit certain things. The very first one, Stephenville, Montana, we walked into the sorriest excuse of an adult Sunday school class I'd ever seen in my life. And the guy would get up, he'd open the Word of God, and he'd read a Bible verse. Not even very well, by the way. Read a Bible verse. And he says,
Praise the Lord. Bless God. Any comments? Then you read the next one. Praise the Lord. Bless God. Any comments? Nothing else. There was no reading distinctly. There was no giving the sense. There's no causing the people to understand. And my wife and I are looking at each other and we're going, oh boy. It did eventually change. It took a little while. But here's the thing. Look what happens in verse 9. And Nehemiah, which is the Tirshasha, and Ezra, the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto all the people, this day is holy unto the Lord your God. Mourn not, nor weep. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. The word of God is present. Attention is present. Tears are present. When a revival is seen through the word of God. What do the tears mean? Tears happen when all of a sudden God's word is not just to the masses. Tears happen when you're sitting in the masses and all of a sudden God zeroes in on you. And you realize and you become aware, wait a minute. This isn't the pastor trying to speak to people. This is God through the Holy Spirit speaking personally to me. By the way, this is why people get mad at pastors sometimes. I've had the phone call. You're preaching at me. I was. What did I say? You said, da-da-da-da-da-da. I said, yeah, and they said, and I'm making this decision to do this. And I go, oh, really? I didn't know that. And then you kind of hear the stuttering and stammering and the backpedaling going on in the background. Well, it sure seemed kind of appropriate. But this is the thing. Tears happen when God's word becomes personal. And you realize, wait a minute, I thought God's word was for everybody else. And the reality is, no, it's for you. And it's for you personally. And when the pastor preaches, he's not preaching to everybody else. He's preaching to you. Or I should say the Holy Spirit of God is preaching to you. And that is a great revelation when that happens and you realize that God has zeroed in on you. And very often it can have a very, very emotional effect when all of a sudden the light bulb goes off and you go, this is for me. And I don't know what is going on with anybody else and I now no longer care what is going on with anybody else. I know that God is speaking to me. This is the same church, the service ended and all of a sudden this lady came up and she sat down, she wanted to talk to me. She is crying and shaking so hard she could hardly speak. And eventually later she sent me a letter and she said, in the service my heart was beating so fast because I knew that God was bringing me back to him. And the Holy Spirit of God was speaking to me in a personal way. This is what happens with the Word of God. The Word of God is present. And that's when God's Word is esteemed. Attention is present. This is when God's Word is worth hearing. Tears are present. This is when God's Word speaks personally. Oh boy, here it comes. Obedience is present. Obedience is present when a revival comes. Look me at Nehemiah chapter 8. Look at verse 14. Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 14. And they found written in the law which the Lord had commanded by Moses that the children of Israel should dwell in booths in the feast of the seventh month. And that they should publish and proclaim in all their cities in Jerusalem, saying, go forth unto the mount and fetch olive branches and pine branches and myrtle branches and palm branches and branches of thick trees to make booths as it is written. By the way, they weren't making telephone booths. The word booths in the Old English, it means they're making tents. They're making tabernacles. They're making personal tents to remind them that they were wanderers in the wilderness for 40 years and God took care of every need they had while they were there. He took care of manna, and quail, their shoes never wore out. I'm sorry, some of these places you go to right now, your shoes aren't even going to last a year. Their shoes never wore out. Their clothes never wore out. We often don't think about that. 40 years. And what it is the purpose of the Feast of Booths was to remind them of how much God is able to do to take care of his people. And said, guess what happened? So the people went forth and brought them and made themselves booths, every one upon the roof of the house and in their courts, and in the courts of the house of God, and in the street of the water gate, and in the street of the gate of Ephraim. Obedience is present in God's house. Among God's people, revival happens when obedience is present. And this is where we talked about how God's word is esteemed and God's word is worth hearing. And God's word speaks personally, but obedience is present when God's word is heeded. When we look at God's word and say, oh, God said to do that, I should do that. That's obedience. And revival is part of that. What else happens? Look at verse 17. And all the congregation of them that were come again out of the captivity made booths and sat under the booths. Look at this. For since the days of Joshua the son of Nun unto that day had not the children of Israel done so. We are talking about between 900 and 1,000 years. They had not done it. Oh, they'd had the ceremonies in town where, okay, it's the Feast of Booths, and you know, and you go down the city hall and the city square, and you go into downtown Jerusalem, and up by the temple they had a booth there. That was their Feast of Booths. But they'd never done this where the Word of God commanded, where, no, each one of you personally is supposed to make a booth. 900 years. And you know what happens when God's people discover they should have done something, and then they do it, and then they accomplish it? What happened? And there was very great gladness. In other words, we're halfway here. The Word of God is present with this revival. Attention is present. Tears are present. Obedience is present. And joy is present. Because not only was God's Word heeded, but remember this, God's Word is transforming. And that's one of the purposes of the Word of God, is to change your life, to transform your life, to turn things from darkness to light and from one direction to another. That is the purpose of the very written Word of God. So what else is present? What happened the next day? Very interesting. Now on the 24th day, see, am I reading right? No, I'm not. Okay. Go to verse, oh, there it is, verse 18. Also, day by day, from the first day unto the last day, he read in the book of the law of God, and they kept the feast 7 days, and on the eighth day it was a solemn assembly according to the manner. But here's something else that happens when revival happens. Spiritual hunger is present. And the Word of God is heard Sunday morning. And it isn't enough. And the Word of God is heard Sunday night. And it isn't enough. And then you have to wait all the way to Wednesday to hear the Word of God again. It isn't enough. It isn't enough. It isn't enough. It isn't enough because there's a spiritual hunger. And people are driven to the Word and driven into the Word. And here, I'm sorry, you didn't have a lot of copies of these floating around Jerusalem back then. You know, there was the preacher's copy, and there really wasn't any other copy. And so if you're going to hear the Word of God, you're going to have to go to Ezra's house and go, hey, Ezra! Ezra, sun's rising! Ezra, time to get up! Hey, what time is it? Is it the Sabbath? No, it's Tuesday, but we want to hear the Word of God again. It's a hunger for the Word of God. And that's something also, because all of a sudden, God's word is more than speaking personally, and God's word is more than being heeded, and God's word is more than transforming. God's word is becoming perpetual in our lives. What's so interesting is Job understood this before there was a word of God. Think about this. He's talking about God's word. He says, I esteem thy words more than my necessary food. And understand that when Job said that, the word of God had not yet been written. But that's how valuable he considered God's word in his life. Spiritual hunger is present. This brings us to the seventh point. Now we're going to leave Nehemiah. We're going to go to Acts chapter 4. Book of Acts chapter 4. What are we saying again? Where is revival seen? It is seen in God's house among God's people. That's where historically it has always taken place. There's never been any exception to this rule. It has always been when God's people assemble according to God's purpose. Whether they assembled in the Old Testament, around the tabernacle, or around the temple, or around the word, or in the New Testament, when they assembled together for what God was making, which was the church. Look here, Acts chapter 4, verse 23. And let me just give a little bit of background here. God used Peter and John to heal somebody, and everybody got mad. Everybody got mad that something good happened to somebody. Why did they get mad? Because something good happened to somebody. Because the good thing that happened to somebody happened in the name of Jesus Christ. And some people who did not like the name of Jesus Christ, they were beside themselves. And they called Peter and John into their idea of a kangaroo courtroom. And they threatened them and said, you're not going to talk about Jesus anymore. And, you know, Paul and John, you know, they're very quiet, compliant people. They said, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than unto God, judge ye. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. And then they went back to the church building where everybody else was. It says in verse 23 of Acts chapter 4, and being let go, they went to their own company and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said unto them. And when they heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord. Welcome to prayer meeting, folks. And said, Lord, thou art God. I think that's the most important thing to figure out. Nobody else is. Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all that in them is, who by the mouth of thy servant David has said, why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things? The kings of the earth stood up and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For of a truth against thy holy child Jesus, whom thou hast anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the people of Israel, were gathered together for to do whatsoever thy hand and thy counsel determined before to be done. And now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word by stretching forth thine hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus. Where is revival seen? In God's house, among God's people. And when revival happens and it's in God's house and among God's people, prayer is present. This is the seventh point. Prayer is present. Because what it means is we know who to talk to about our problems. Oh, I have a problem. Maybe this will fix my problem. Nah, usually it gives you a bigger problem. Maybe I can call somebody. Maybe I have a lifeline. I'll call a medical official. After all, we all know that you know, medical people, they have answers to all the problems. If they call you back. If they'll schedule an appointment. This year. Maybe next year. Or wait a minute, I saw as I was going through the phone book, I saw the word psycho. Let me call somebody psycho. Let me call a psychologist or a psychotherapist or a psychoanalyst or a psychiatrist. Let me call somebody psycho. Somebody psycho can help me. After all, years and years ago, I saw the movie Psycho, and it gave me mental problems, so I'm sure somebody psycho can help. Revival happens when prayer is present, and you realize that the answer is Him. And He is the first one to talk to. Most of the time, He's the only one to talk to. Sorry to say, sometimes we are just kind of little roving dump trucks. We're just kind of running through the building, and somebody goes, "How was your day?" Boop, 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 dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee. Another person running around in their little dump truck. "Hey, how was your day?" "I'm glad you asked." Boop, 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 boop. We all get buried in each other's problems because we didn't talk to Him first. We should talk to Him first. Prayer is present. But what comes after prayer? Look at verse 31. "And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness." I'm bouncing down the rabbit trail right here. This is a rabbit trail. Here I go. I'm away from the pulpit. I'm on a rabbit trail, bunny trail. I'm coming back. True story. Caleb and I in Myanmar, and I am speaking this very passage, and we hear a rumble in the distance. And the rumble becomes a roar. And the roar becomes a tropical thunderstorm. With that rain going down that tin roof as hard as you can and water beginning to run in. And then it became a tropical hailstorm. Do you realize how violent a tropical hailstorm has to be when you're only at latitude 16 degrees north? And right as I'm reading that verse, the roar is so loud that I am screaming at the top of my lungs, and Brother Paul Van Ray, who's speaking in Burmese, is screaming at the top of his lungs. Best object lesson I ever had. But understand, where prayer is present, God's power is on His way. And revival is seen in God's house, among God's people, when God's power is present, and God's power does show up. What else is present? Look at verse 31. "And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness." Because you see, something else is present when revival takes place. The gospel is present. The gospel of Jesus Christ is present. And what did they go out to speak? Here's what it was. Look here. Verse 33. "And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And great grace was upon them all." The gospel was present. And look at all these things that exist, but remember that none of it will happen except in God's house, among God's people. It's not going to happen when you're at home. It's not going to get blipped on your smartphone. It's not going to show up at your big screen. It's not going to show up at Safeway. It's not going to show up at the ball field. It's not going to show up at the convention center. It's going to show up in the house of God is where it's going to show up. And we're almost there. But you have the Word of God that is present, and then attention to the Word of God is present. And then when there's Word of God and attention and God begins to work, tears are present, and then obedience is present. And then when obedience is accomplished, then joy is present. And then when joy is present, you go, I have enjoyed this so much, I want a little bit more of this. Then spiritual hunger is present. And with the Word of God, prayer is present. And when prayer is there, then power is present. And then with power, the gospel is present. Because understand, if God's going to empower, God's not just going to empower you just so you can go out like a little Energizer battery and hum while you're doing your Safeway shopping. No, he's doing it for a purpose, and the purpose is the Word of God. And the greatest part of the Word of God is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Something else happens. Get verse 32 of Acts chapter 4. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which possessed was his own, but they had all things common. Well, how did they know what anybody else had? How are you doing? Do you have any needs? Do you have any needs? Do you have any needs? Shoes are okay? Getting enough food? Maybe I should ask Dad. Dad, is there enough food in the house? Are you being taken care of? Danelle, what about you? Oh, he said point to Sharon. Sharon, okay. Is everything okay? Is there any German cake left over? No, just kidding. But I'm not the only one doing that. Brother Jim's walking around and asking the same question. Glenn's asking the same question. Mrs. Watkins is asking the same question. Dave and Joanne are going around asking the same question. That's how that happens. Where all of a sudden, everybody in a congregation becomes concerned that one another's needs is being taken care of. And that happens with revival. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24, which just simply says, and let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. And this is what happens, and this is part of revival that takes place in God's house, among God's people, where everybody is concerned with how everybody else is doing. And not so that they can then take that and report it all to the pastor. And not so that we can use it and gossip to one another about it. But it's that we're genuinely concerned. We want to see people's needs met. If somebody else in the congregation is discouraged, we're bothered by it. If somebody else has tears, and it's not tears because of the Word of God, but it's tears because there's grief, we're bothered by it. It's that all of a sudden we consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. And that is literally to encourage each other all to do the right thing. All to live the right way. Not for any benefit that we have and not to criticize them, but because we want to see people grow in Christ. And we want to see people grow in love, and we want to see people have success in their life and success in their spiritual condition. And I've already told the men this, you know, we can't carry another person's spiritual burden. It's not humanly possible. But we can cast that burden just like they're supposed to, where it says, casting all your cares upon him, for he careth for you. And if somebody talks to us, what do? We then take their cares and we cast them to God. Somebody else has a care, we cast it to God. Somebody has a need, we don't have a clue how that need's going to be met. We cast it to God. Sometimes we can meet needs, sometimes we can't. Sometimes somebody has two weed eaters. Somebody needs one. Give them one. Sometimes somebody has two loaves of bread. Somebody needs one. You give them one. Sometimes we have five different crescent wrenches, but we only know where one of the five is. We could find the other four. We could give them out. It says they had all things common. But we consider one another to provoke into love and good works. 10 things. If you're writing on your fingers and you missed one, I'll give me the marker. I'll get the other one written for you. Here's the amazing thing, though, about revival. When revival happens, God makes His presence known in the midst of His people. And it's happened over and over again in Scripture. I mean, it started all the way back in the book of Exodus, looking in chapter 13, and I'll just read these quickly, but chapter 13, verse 21, and it said, "And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go by day and night. He took not away the pillar of fire and the cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people." What was that? God's presence in the midst of the people. And then by the power and the instruction of God, they build a tabernacle. Well, what happened with that tabernacle? Exodus 40, verse 34. "Then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle, and Moses was not able to enter into the tent of the congregation because the cloud abode thereon, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle." What was that? That was the presence of God in the midst of His people. But it happened again. And in the book of 1 Kings, looking at chapter 8 and looking at verse 10, it says, "And it came to pass, when the priests were come out of the holy place, that the cloud filled the house of the Lord, so that the priests could not stand to minister because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of the Lord." What happened? God made His presence known in the midst of the people. But it doesn't stop there. And this, of course, is a very familiar passage to us. And many of you realize that this was a sign of what God was doing. And it was a sign of what God was doing, which for us now is our present day experience that we sometimes take for granted now. Acts chapter 2, it says, "And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven like as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting." What was that? That was the presence of God in the midst of the people of God. And what we forget is the presence of God already is here in the midst of the people of God, in the heart and the life of every born-again believer that names the name of Jesus Christ. You're already indwelt by His Holy Spirit, that Holy Spirit of God that knows how to illuminate, that Holy Spirit of God that knows how to reveal things, that Holy Spirit of God that knows how to lead, that knows how to convict, that knows how to empower, that knows how to love. God makes His presence known in the midst of the people in the assembly. And we just read this one. "And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness." God makes His presence known in the midst of His people. And we don't need another Pentecost. Pentecost has already come. What we need is God's presence in His church and in our lives. Dear Heavenly Father, as we look into Your Word, there's so many things to say, and there's not enough time to say it. We know what you have done. And history shows us what you are able to do. You had one disciple, his name was Thomas, called Didymus. And he was a doubter. And he didn't have faith that you did what you said you would do, even with everybody around him telling him that you did it. Sometimes, Lord, I confess, we walk around as if we're all doubting Thomas's. Having seen plainly in your word what you have done, and even seen in history what you have done, and then we walk around and go, I doubt he'll do it again. And we have no reason to doubt. And we have no right to doubt. Because you are our God. And you are in the midst of your people. And you can do all things. Help us in faith to believe you, and help us in faith to embrace your truth of who you are with men. This is impossible, but with God all things are possible. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And as we stand, number 160, so many things in our life is what we put our focus on. And the devil is the author and authority on distraction. To get our eyes on so many things that don't really matter, to worry about things that in the end will not really matter. But there's somebody we should always be focused on, and that is Jesus. And that is what he has done. And that is what he is still doing. He is still at the right hand of God. And the next time he leaves that spot, he's coming for you. We need to focus on him. Let's sing this song, 160. Let's sing it heartfelt. If you have a need, the altar is open. Let's lift our voices to him and our prayers to him.
Oh, soul.